Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, both everyone gathered in this room and all of those gathered in the overflow video room down the hall. What a terrific problem to have. Welcome to all of you. I'm Professor Ken Bamberger, and on behalf of Law School Dean Christopher Headley and Professor Laurent Maillet, the director of the Robbins Collection for Religious and Civil Law, I want to welcome you all to the fourth annual Robbins Collection Lecture on Jewish Law and Thought. It's truly an honor for all of us to be able to welcome to campus a leading thinker who has had such influence on so many in his first visit to Northern California. Before the Chief Rabbi is introduced, I want to just say a few words about our two hosts, the Robbins Collection and the Berkeley Institute for Jewish Law and Israeli Law, Economy, and Society, of which I'm the faculty director. The Robbins Collection was established in 1952, and it has since, with a history of leaders such as the late David Daubin and its current director, Professor Maillet, become a leading international center for comparative legal and historical studies, with particular strength in religious law. It attracts students and leading scholars from universities and research institutions around the world. Its library ranks among the very best in the fields of religious and civil law. It's right here at Berkeley. And this year it hosts its first triad of postgraduate fellows, one each in canon law, Islamic law, and Jewish law, the latter being Professor Leon Wiener Dow, who's teaching the university's first course in modern Jewish thought in the Jewish law program, in the Jewish studies program. The Berkeley Institute is an interdisciplinary cross-campus initiative to expand Jewish and Israel studies offerings at UC Berkeley. The Institute was launched in 2011 and is led by a 16-member faculty committee drawn from across campus, economics, history, Jewish studies, music, political science, sociology, law, journalism, and business. And the Institute's two initiatives, one focused on Jewish law and civilization, and the other on the multidisciplinary study of Israel, serve undergraduates, graduate students, and faculty by developing opportunities for research, programming, visiting scholars, colloquia, and classes to strengthen academic inquiry and discourse across the Cal campus. Programs like this one are just the surface of our vibrant, developing community. And I urge you to visit our website. Just Google Berkeley Institute and Jewish or Berkeley Institute and Israeli to learn about the full panoply of ways you can be involved and become a supporter of our efforts. Now, to introduce the Chief Rabbi, it's my pleasure to turn the mic over to UC Berkeley's Executive Vice Chancellor and Provost, George Breslauer. George, along with Chancellor Bergeneau, has been such a committed presence on campus with respect to initiatives enhancing the vibrancy of Jewish studies resources here at Cal, including our efforts, those of the Magnus Collection, and many others. So, with great thanks, I introduce Executive Vice Chancellor and Provost Breslauer.
Thank you, Ken. And thanks to the law school, to the Robbins Collection, to the Berkeley Institute for hosting this event tonight. The Berkeley Institute's efforts over the last 2 years have made such an extraordinary contribution to Jewish studies classes, programs, and community here at Cal. And on behalf of myself, Chancellor Robert Bergeneau, and the entire university, it is quite an honor for me to have this opportunity to welcome Chief Rabbi Lord Jonathan Sacks and Lady Sacks on the occasion of this annual Robbins Lecture. Let me say a few words about Rabbi Sacks' background, his intellectual contribution, and then on a personal note speak about why it's such a personal thrill for me to be up here introducing Rabbi Sacks. As far as his background is concerned, since 1991, Rabbi Sacks has served as the sixth chief rabbi of the United Hebrew Congregations of the British Commonwealth, the Federation of Synagogues formally recognized by the British government since 1845. He is also visiting professor of theology at King's College London. Rabbi Sacks attended Gonville and Caius College, Cambridge, receiving honors in philosophy, and continued his studies at New College, Oxford, and King's College, London, where he earned his doctorate in 1981. The same year, he received rabbinical ordination at Jews College and at Yeshiva Etz Chaim, both in London. Before taking the post of chief rabbi, Rabbi Sacks served as rabbi for the Golders Green and Marble Arch synagogues in London, and was also principal of Jews College, the world's oldest rabbinical seminary. Now let me say a word about his intellectual contributions. The Times of London put it succinctly and accurately when it recently described Rabbi Sacks as one of the most engaging thinkers of our time. He is an extremely prolific writer and thinker, having written 24 books, his most recent being The Great Partnership, God, Science, and the Search for Meaning, which came out in the year 2011. His work has been characterized by leadership in a number of important areas. One, an engagement with sacred thought that transcends both religious and sectarian boundaries. Two, a focus on the ways in which fundamental contributions of the Jewish tradition provide essential complements to the accomplishments of modernity. And third, an emphasis on the centrality of the core values of the intertwined Jewish legal and ethical inheritance. Rabbi Sacks has received 14 honorary doctorates, including a doctorate of divinity conferred by the Archbishop of Canterbury, a 2005 knighthood conferred by the Queen of England, an invitation to join the House of Lords in 2009, and two National Jewish Book Awards in the United States. In the words of former British Prime Minister Gordon Brown, Rabbi Sacks, quote, has done more than anyone in Britain today to focus our attention on the needs and challenges of community in the global world. And now finally, on a personal note, late in the year 2004, I was flying back from Europe and I wandered into a bookstore in Paris looking for something to read on the airplane. And I came across this book called The Dignity of Difference. And I read it on the plane back, and it was an extraordinary read, written by Rabbi Sacks. The book so inspired me because it really spoke to what I was searching for. It so inspired me that when I became provost, I gave my copy of that book to the chancellor because he himself stands for the dignity of difference, equity, and inclusion at UC Berkeley. A few months later, I ran into Amitai Etzioni, a social theorist at George Mason University, now I believe he's at George Washington, and I mentioned the book to him, and he said, Jonathan Sacks is the most electrifying speaker I have ever heard in my life. So when, a couple of years ago, Ken Bamberger and I had lunch to talk about the new Berkeley Institute, I said to him, you know, it would be phenomenal if we could get Rabbi Jonathan Sacks to come to Berkeley to speak at this institute. And now, my dream has come true. It is my pleasure to welcome to UC Berkeley Chief Rabbi Lord Jonathan Sacks.
Vice-Chancellor, friends, what do you say after that? I think everything's going to be an anticlimax, especially suffering from acute jet lag as I am, and I feel very, very much like the English gentleman who once dreamt he was giving a speech in the House of Lords and woke up to discover he was. Friends, may I say what an incredible privilege it is to be here in one of the very greatest universities in the world, to pay tribute to this institute, your program of Jewish and indeed Israeli studies, and to pay tribute to the wonderful director of the institute, Professor Kenneth Bamberger, who is just an outstanding academic and human being. I want to thank George himself, Executive Vice-Chancellor George Breslau, and indeed Chancellor Roland Birgenau and Law School Dean Chris Edley for the incredible support they've given to the development of Jewish studies here on the campus, to pay tribute to the extraordinary team of scholars that you've assembled. And I know it's invidious to mention names, but I must personally pay tribute, say personally how inspired I have been throughout my reading career, reading life by Professor Robert Alter and his wonderful work on biblical narrative and poetry. He's been a huge inspiration to me. I also want to thank the university, to thank Berkeley for its principled support for a Jewish voice here in a time which has sometimes been a torrid time for Jewish students throughout the world. I believe that universities are citizens of a free society because there are places where every voice is given a respectful hearing, even those voices with which we disagree. And a Jewish voice is so important in the conversation of humankind. And here I want to mention a personal connection with Berkeley because my doctoral supervisor was the late Sir Bernard Williams, who taught philosophy here for many years. And he was probably the greatest moral philosopher of his time. And our relationship was absolutely wonderful. I mean, totally improbable, because he was a committed atheist. And I was quite firm, quite religious in those days. You know, I've kind of declined since. But the truth is that we were completely opposite ends of the intellectual spectrum, yet I learned so much from him, and I pay tribute to that in the great partnership. And I learned from him exactly what is involved in the collaborative pursuit of truth, which is what a university must be and must never be less than that. So I salute you and bless you for all of that. But I have, just by way of introduction, one other personal connection, specifically with the Robbins collection. And that was an academic whom I met only once in my life when I was a sophomore, second-year student, but I've never forgotten that encounter. That was a previous director of the Robbins Collection, the late Professor David Dalberg, blessed memory. David Dalberg was one of the world's great scholars in three separate fields, Jewish biblical studies, New Testament studies, and of course, his main subject, Roman law, where he was Regius Professor at Oxford University. Very Germanic and proper man, but a man with the best sense of humor that I have ever met. And on that occasion, back in 1968, he told me the funniest story I have ever heard, and I take this privilege of repeating it in his memory. So forgive me if you've heard it. But he asked me, what am I studying? And I said, Professor Dalberg, I'm studying philosophy. Terrible subject, he said, give it up immediately.
Philosophers are the most useless people you'll ever meet in the world. They're always deep into metaphysical speculation. They have no idea what's going on in the world. Who is your favorite philosopher? Now, if you were studying philosophy at Cambridge in the 60s, you could only give one answer. Wittgenstein. I thought so, he said. And he then proceeded to tell me the following story, which I remember as if it was yesterday. He said, Professor Wittgenstein was standing with two of his disciples, Professor H.L.A. Harvard, Professor of Jurisprudence at Oxford, and Professor Elizabeth Anscombe, and they were standing at the Cambridge station waiting for the London train, and they were so deep in philosophical conversation that they completely failed to notice the train as it steamed into the station. They were still talking as people got off and got on, and it was only as it was leaving the station that they looked up and realized the train was leaving. And then Professor Hart ran and heaved himself on board. And I can just tell you, imagine to recapture his German accent. And Elizabeth Anscombe, an enormous woman, ran and heaved herself on board. And poor old Wittgenstein ran but could not catch the train and was left stranded and alone on the platform. And he looked so crestfallen that a woman was moved to come up to him and say, don't worry, there's going to be another train in an hour's time. And he turned to her and said, you don't understand. They came to see me off. Professor around the law want to be friends. I've been asked to say a few words this evening about the future of Judaism. And in fact, I'm going to be slightly unconventional. I am not going to do the conventional thing and tell you what I think will happen to Judaism and the Jewish people in the 21st century. I wrote a book on that called Future Tense. Read the book. The truth is, I haven't got a clue. You haven't got a clue. I remember somebody asking Professor Bernard Lewis back in 2003, maybe the world's greatest expert on Islam, to say what was going to happen in the Middle East. And he gave a most brilliant reply. He said, I'm a historian, so I only make predictions about the past. What is more, he said, I am a retired historian, therefore even my past is passé. So therefore, I want to ask actually a fundamental and very serious question that goes to the heart of this institute and to Jewish studies here in Berkeley and in campuses generally, namely, why Judaism? What does it have to say? Not just to Jews, but to the world. And not just then, in ancient times, but now. After all, people like Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, and others ask whether God and religion, in any form, have a continuing and relevant place in our culture. So what, then, could be the conceivable influence of Judaism, which is not only a religion, but is also so tiny a religion that, as Milton, the late Milton Himmelfarb once said, think about it, the sum total of population of Jews in the world is smaller than the statistical error in the Chinese census. I want to argue otherwise. And obviously within the time constraints, I will sketch my argument in very broad brush strokes. But I want to point to a feature of Western civilization that I believe is fundamental and yet insufficiently reflected on, which tends to be concealed from our awareness. We are about to celebrate the Jewish festival of Hanukkah, the battle between Jews and Greeks in the second pre-Christian century. Perhaps the world's first clash of civilizations, as opposed to clashes of armies and empires. They were two profoundly different civilizations. Greece was culture of the eye, and Judaism was culture of the ear. Greece was a culture with a morality of shame. Judaism was a culture with a morality of guilt. Two things about which Bernard Williams wrote one of his great books, and he wrote it here in Berkeley, called Shame and Necessity. And Western civilization was founded on the basis of Christianity and its synthesis between the two. All of that is familiar. However, there is one strange fact about Christianity that I think has not been sufficiently reflected on, and that is this. The founder of Christianity was a Jew who read scriptures in Hebrew and spoke the language of Israel at the time, namely Aramaic. However, all the early Christian texts, without exception, were written in Greek. And even for centuries, even the Hebrew Bible was read by Christians in Greek translation, in the Septuagint translation. Now, the Greeks were the first people to think systematically, to develop abstract conceptualizations. They were the first to lay the foundations for both philosophy and science. Jews thought in a different way. For instance, Michael Walzer, the Princeton political philosopher, has just published a book called In God's Shadow, Politics in the Hebrew Bible, and he points out that there's a lot of politics in the Bible, but no systematic account of political concepts, such as you find in Plato's Republic and the Laws, or in Aristotle's Politics. Jews respected science. They even coined a blessing on seeing Gentile scientists, but they made very little effort to contribute to science until the modern age. So Greece, that developed both philosophy and science, Jews didn't. And even their concept of knowledge was radically different. For the Greeks, knowledge was cognitive. And it was acquired in a state of detachment. The Greeks even thought, and it gave us in the West, their fundamental metaphor for all knowledge, which is seeing. How do we say? We talk about foresight, insight, hindsight. We say somebody made an observation, somebody took a perspective. When you understand something, you say, I see. Whereas for Jews, all the metaphors of knowledge have to do with hearing. Shmamina, kamashmalan, lo shmiale, mipiashmoa, these are all hearing metaphors. For Jews, knowledge is not a matter of detachment, it's a matter of attachment. It's a matter of personal intimacy. Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and became pregnant. We call that knowledge in the biblical sense. But you understand, knowledge, and the children of Israel cried out because of their suffering, and God knew, meaning not that he was cognizant of something, he knows everything, but he was moved to compassion. So for Jews, knowledge is completely different. It's to do with interpersonal and empathy and sympathy. For Greeks, the essential contrast in knowledge is between the subjective belief and objective reality. In Judaism, all knowledge is intersubjective. Truth in the Hebrew Bible is not scientific, it's not metaphysical, it's moral. When we talk about a God of truth, we mean the God who does what he says he is going to do. It is the moral attribute of keeping your word. And so, systematically, you have here you have here different approaches to almost everything. There is, for instance, something very interesting, a biblical concept of morality, which I believe only two people fully understood, neither of whom, for quite different reasons, attributed it to Jews or the Hebrew Bible. The two most insightful writers on the origins of morality were Friedrich Nietzsche in his book On the Genealogy of Morals and Hannah Arendt in her book The Human Condition. And both of them saw that the origin of morality is an act of promising. And an act of promising is a very specialized use of language. Since the Oxford philosopher J.L. Austin, we have called that use of language a performative utterance. The use of language not to describe, but to create. When you make a promise, you create something that didn't exist before, namely a moral obligation. And that concept of morality is developed most systematically in Judaism. In Judaism, morality begins in that act of mutual promising that we call a covenant. That is a very distinctive view of morality which the Greeks didn't have, which is central to the Jewish Bible. And therefore, we have two completely different cultures. And work this one out. Western civilization was built through a religion that took a biblical faith that only lives and breathes in the Hebrew language and translated it into Greek. For 2,000 years, the West has lived on an act of mistranslation. And what I wanted to point, I actually pointed this out to Michael Krasny this morning, that not all languages are translatable into one another. For instance, I mentioned that some years back I received something called the Jerusalem Prize, which is a nice prize because you get it in Jerusalem, on Jerusalem Day, and it's handed to you by the President of the State of Israel. And it's nice to have because it gives nachas to your parents, which is any of us do anything. Now, on that occasion, the President of the State of Israel was the late Asa Weizmann, who was somewhat secular, to put it mildly, and he was speaking in Hebrew, thank goodness, and my parents didn't understand what he was saying. And he made the following speech. I summarize it as follows. I see Rabbi Sacks has received the prize for his contributions to religious education in the diaspora. Well, he said, religious education is better than nothing, but then proceeded to deliver a wonderful speech on how we should get rid of all this religious nonsense and institute secular Jewish schools. Now, after this wonderful occasion, I came back to London and I had breakfast with the Israeli ambassador and I said, Mr. Ambassador, now I understand why after 4,000 years, the Hebrew language still does not have a word that means pact. Does this surprise anyone? It actually doesn't. You know, when you ask an Israeli, what's tact? Tact, but it's written, said tact. You know, you have to use the English word. So therefore, the key concepts in any civilization are very often not translatable from one to the other, and that has led to a skewing of some of the central concepts in our culture. I want to take the absolutely classic example. When Moses encounters God in the burning bush and asks him, who are you? What is your name? God replies in three famous Hebrew words, Eheyeh, Asher, Eheyeh. And until very recently, whether we are dealing with the Greek translations, the Latin translations, or I will just focus on the non-Jewish Christian translations. How are those words translated? I am what I am. I am who I am. I am that I am. Or my favorite, I am, that's who I am. Now, any Jewish child who ever studied Hebrew knows that though every single one of those is a mistranslation. Eheyeh, Asher Eheyeh means I will be what or how I will be. God's name is the future tense. Now, this is a misunderstanding of the most fundamental kind. What the Greek and Latin and English translations all implied, I am that I am, is that God is the ground of being, the first cause, the unmoved mover, the necessity at the heart of contingency, the being, that is the object of all the famous proofs of Anselm and Aquinas, the cosmological proof, the teleological proof, and the ontological proof. All of those flow from that one foundational mistranslation, all of which are light years away from the Hebrew Eheyeh, Asher Eheyeh, which roughly means, don't try and conceptualize me, don't try and categorize me, don't try and predict me, because I, God, am a free agent, I am what I choose to be. Therefore, I cannot be inferred from any scientific inference or any logical proof. I am encountered not in the physical, not in the metaphysical, but in history. You will not know what I am until I'm there and until you are there. I am encountered in the dimension of time. And that tells us that for the Hebrew Bible, for Jews, God is not in nature, but the creator of nature. He's not in the universe, but beyond the universe. Therefore, he is radically free. He is beyond all those laws of necessity that govern nature. And hence, the great generative drama of the Hebrew Bible, which is that God, who is radically free, confers that radical freedom on us by creating us in his image. And the story of the Hebrew Bible, the story of civilization, as far as Jews are concerned, is how human beings use or misuse that freedom, which can be summed up in two sentences. God creates order, we create chaos. That is the Hebrew Bible in miniature. First Adam and Eve, then Cain and Abel, then the generation of the flood, then the builders of Babel. You know, they say, they tell the young man is trying to learn Yiddish and can't think of the Yiddish word for disappointed. So he goes to his elder Bubba, his old grandmother, and says, Bubba, if you want to say in Yiddish, what would you say for I'm disappointed? And she says, well, in Yiddish, you say, Ich bin disappointed. So if you had asked God at the end of Genesis, you know, how do you feel about this man you created? He would say, bin ich disappointed. And there is, of course, only one way of reconciling human order with human freedom, and that is through law. But by this we mean moral law as opposed to scientific law. The word law means something different in those two phrases, in science and in jurisprudence. In science, you can refute a law. In morality, you can break a law, but those are two completely different things. Scientific law is descriptive, moral law is prescriptive, and you cannot infer one from the other. So the idea that you can prove God from metaphysics or from science completely has no place in Judaism and only has a place in Western civilization because of the mistranslation of those three words, Eyeh Asher Eyeh. I want to stay with this point because it's absolutely fundamental. And the implications are not yet fully understood by today's scientific atheists, the angry atheists, as I call them. I wouldn't possibly say anything as rude as this, but you know, when you mix with really bright academics, they have an altogether more wonderful way of insulting people, don't they, with such grace. I love the Oxford Don who said about another Oxford Don, on the surface, he's profound. But deep down, he's superficial. And that, I'm afraid, is what I have to say about the new atheist, Richard Dawkins et al. I love them dearly, but they're deep down superficial. And I want to now explain something absolutely fundamental that they really don't understand. Their attempt to displace theology by science falls or results in this very significant phenomenon. To provide a scientific explanation for any phenomenon is to show that X is the cause of Y, where Y precedes X in time. An event cannot precede its cause. So therefore, any scientific explanation is always explaining something in the present by reference to something in the past. But when it comes to human action, the precise reverse is the case. To understand the act of somebody, you have to understand what that person was trying to achieve, i.e., some future state of affairs that doesn't yet exist. All intentional human action, as opposed to mere instinctive behavior, is always future-oriented. In fact, the very basis of human freedom is the product of our ability to imagine a future that does not yet exist and to act to bring it about. Human freedom exists only because we can think in the future tense. And the human future, as Karl Popper showed in his refutation of historical inevitability, the human future is constitutively unknowable. We look, we think, we know almost everything. We look out to the universe and we see a cosmos 13.7 billion light years across, and with 100 billion galaxies, each of 100 billion stars. We look inside of the human body, and we know that every human body, there are 100 trillion cells. Within each cell, there's a double copy of the human genome, which contains 3.1 billion letters of genetic code, which, if transcribed, would produce a library of 5,000 volumes of 80,000 words each. And we think we know everything. The truth is, however much we know, there is still one undiscovered country left, and it is called the future. We may know everything else, but we cannot know what tomorrow will bring. Why is the future not just unknown, or not just, as someone Rumsfeld used to say, an unknown unknown, but constitutively unknowable? Because we make it, and we are free. And that open future is the future tense, is the sole basis of human freedom. In other words, we are constitutive. I mean, Sartre said we are the people whose existence precedes our essence, but the Bible tells us what human freedom is. It is the ability to say, I will be what I choose to be, because I am free, because I am made in the image of the free God who so defined himself. Now, the Hebrew Bible does not take freedom for granted. You have to work to achieve that freedom. Again, as I mentioned this morning, you know, Jews make pretty good heretics, you know. You know the word Epicurus. We're pretty good at heretics. Three of the world's great heretics of the modern world were Jewish. Three of the four, Spinoza, Marx, and Freud. The one who wasn't Jewish was Charles Darwin. Why Charles Darwin wasn't Jewish, I have no idea. Humbly, a total Epicurus. He had every qualification, like you conclude, is it was a random genetic mutation. However, the three Jewish Epicurus, all had in common that they were determinists. They denied human freedom. Spinoza said, we are all determined by the conatus, the will to survive. Marx said, all human history is driven by the competition of classes and the ownership of property. Freud said, all human behavior is driven by early encounter experiences, especially with our father. And I once teasingly said, I don't mean this literally, but I once teasingly said that that is why God's first words to Abraham that set Jewish history in motion were, Lech lecha me'aretzcha me'moladetcha me'beit avicha, leave your land, your birthplace, and your father's house. Marx said, human history is determined by the ownership of land, leave your land. Spinoza said it's determined by genetically encoded instincts of birth, leave the place of your birth. Freud said it's determined by your father, your relationship with your father, leave your father's house. In other words, get yourself free, in the immortal words of Paul Simon. Anyway, so we have to work at freedom, but we are capable of that freedom by working at it. And that is, therefore, scientific explanation, if Dawkins et al. Are correct, if scientific explanation is all the explanation there is, and if we could give an exhaustive explanation of all human behavior, then human freedom ceases to exist. Now, if human freedom ceases to exist, and Sam Harris has written a book about this recently and so on, I don't know whether we fully realize all the consequences that will flow from it. We will then lose the concept of human dignity. We will then lose the concept of the sanctity of human life. We will then lose the very concept of the free society itself. I once asked as part of a television program I made, Richard Dawkins' Oxford colleague and the Oxford neuroscientist Colin Blakemore, who is a hard determinist. I said, Colin, if you really believe what you say, then why should we have laws and courts and trials and a concept of justice? If there is no human freedom, why not just perform neurosurgery on criminals? Or why not simply keep them permanently sedated on psychotropic drugs? And he replied to me, I can see why some people in totalitarian societies might do that, but he entirely failed to understand that logically that would apply to all societies, including the most liberal democracy. If there is no human freedom, there's no human freedom to defend. And then the free society will eventually cease to be. Let me go one stage further. Are you very sports-minded here in Berkeley? Yeah? Would I be right in saying the football stadium here is the largest and most expensive building on the university? This is wonderful. I mean, it's absolutely wonderful. In Britain, we have something called football. It's a slightly different form of football. You call it soccer, right? And famously, one English football manager, Bill Shankly, said, football isn't a matter of life and death. It's much more important than that. And I have to tell you, sorry, this is an aside, sometimes religious leaders have a weakness in this direction as well. I don't know if this story is going to translate into America, but somebody, when I was just chosen but not yet appointed chief rabbi, and George Carey had just been chosen and not yet appointed as Archbishop of Canterbury, somebody discovered that we shared the same passion for a certain football team called Arsenal. I don't know if that name is extended. Yeah, exactly. And said, would you like your first ecumenical gathering to be in my box in Highbury Stadium, at a match? A midweek match for obvious religious reasons. So we both agreed, and we both came, and they brought us down to meet the players, and they brought us out onto the sacred ground itself, out of the floodlights, and an announcement went out through the public address system. We have with us the new Archbishop of Canterbury and the Chief Rabbi. This is a totally true story in every detail. And you could hear the buzz go around the ground that whichever way you played the theological wager, that night Arsenal had friends in high places. They could not possibly lose. That night, November 1990, they went down to their worst home defeat. In 63 years, they lost 6-2 at home to Manchester United. The next day, an English newspaper carried a story saying if the Archbishop of Canterbury and the Chief Rabbi between them could not bring about a win for Arsenal, this not finally proved that God does not exist. The day after, it published my reply, which went as follows. No, it proves that God exists. It's just that he supports Manchester United. Aside, let me get back to the point. Imagine you are trying to explain to the proverbial anthropologist from Mars who has descended to Earth at Berkeley and wants to understand how come people feel so passionate about football. I want you to do this thought experiment to explain to this Martian why people are so passionate about football. You explain to him all the rules of the game. Will that explain it? Of course not. He'll understand the game, the rules and the game, but he won't understand why they get so passionate. And for that, you have to teach him a little bit of sociology and anthropology, get him to read Hutzinger's Homo Ludens and all the rest of it. In other words, I want you to listen carefully to this sentence, the meaning of the system lies outside the system. A point made by Wittgenstein. Now, listen carefully. If the meaning of the system lies outside the system, then the meaning of the universe lies outside the universe. And if that is so, we are able now to see the birth of Abrahamic monotheism in a completely new light. It is not that Abraham did this mathematical reduction from many gods to one. It is that for the first time human beings conceived of a God who radically transcends the universe. And thus for the first time to believe that the universe and life itself has meaning. And that is the revolution of Abrahamic monotheism. And I can give you the simplest statement I know of the meaning of the universe, shared by Jews and Christians, that God created the universe in love and forgiveness, asking us to love and forgive others. And on this proposition, although none of them was, or two of them were not religious believers, on this proposition, Freud, Einstein, and Wittgenstein all concurred. I quote them all in The Great Partnership. The meaningfulness of life stands or falls with the truth or falsity of religion. Now, most ancient religions, most polytheistic religions, and most of today's atheists saw and see human life as a matter of a fate that is at best indifferent and at worst actively hostile to humanity. And that insight, the ultimate meaninglessness of life, formed the basis of one of the greatest contributions of the ancient Greeks to Western civilization, the concept of tragedy. And that is the strand that connects Nietzsche and Freud and Bernard Williams, indeed, in that Berkeley book of his called Shame and Necessity, that life is essentially tragic. And I define Judaism and the Hebrew Bible as the principled defeat of tragedy in the name of hope. And Jewish hope is not mere wishful thinking. It is based on the fact that first, we are free, and therefore not condemned endlessly to repeat the past. Two, we can forgive and be forgiven, therefore not endlessly trapped in the guilt of the past. Three, the faith that we are not alone, that God is with us, lifting us when we fall, forgiving us when we fail. Do not confuse hope with optimism. They are completely different things. Optimism is the belief that things will get better. Hope is the belief that together we can make things better. Optimism is a passive virtue. Hope is an active one. It takes no courage, only a certain kind of naivety, to be an optimist. It takes a great deal of courage to have hope. No Jew, knowing our history, can be an optimist. But no Jew who has faith can ever lose hope. Od lo avda tikvatenu, we never lose hope. What I am trying to tell you is hope is not a free floating concept. It is born and lives and has its being in the love of God for us, his children. We can now therefore see what is at stake, at least for the West, in the 21st century. I began by saying that Western civilization was born in a unique synthesis between ancient Greece and ancient Israel. That synthesis, that was Christianity. Christianity created Western civilization. It was born in the unique synthesis of ancient Greece and ancient Israel. What I think no one has fully understood is that Darwinian natural selection did not refute religion. It refuted Aristotelian science, and therefore any religion that was predicated on Aristotelian science. Aristotle believed that teleological causes, that purposes are discernible in nature. And natural theology in Christianity is built on Aristotelian science. And Darwin says you can have order without that being an order created by purposes conceived in advance. That creates a crisis for the Greek dimension of Christian theology. It presents no crisis whatsoever for the Jewish dimension of Christian theology that was formed on the basis of the Jewish ethic of love and forgiveness, not on nature, law, Anselm, Aquinas, or proofs, scientific or metaphysical whatsoever. Rather, Judaism, that faith in divine love and forgiveness, is based on that consciousness of self and other, from which flow empathy, sympathy, the revelation of self to self through language, and from that those to the moral bond, the mutual covenant, through which two or more persons, each respecting the freedom and dignity of the other, pledge themselves in love and loyalty to one another to achieve together what neither of them can achieve alone, the ultimate being the covenant God makes with us, humanity. And that covenant is the basis of freedom, human dignity, the meaningfulness of life, and hope. If we lose the Jewish voice, whether because Jews cease to be Jews, or because we lose the Jewish dimension of Christianity, then in the future we will begin to lose the distinctive Western sense of human freedom and dignity and hope. We will lose a morality of justice, moral responsibility, guilt, and repentance. We will lose the Jewish ethic of will and choice, and move to a Greek ethic, a tragic ethic of character and fate. We will lose the idea of an overarching meaning of life, and we will lose the ecology of hope to be replaced by the idea of tragedy. And it was the honesty of Bernard Williams when he was here in Berkeley, and he writes in the closing pages of Shame and Necessity, these profoundly wise, though shocking words, although I can't remember them verbatim, he says that far from moving forward in the 21st century, we have moved to the point where we are closer than for 2,000 years or more to the world of the pre-Socratic Greeks. Now that is a possibility. We could move in that direction, to a tragically configured sense of life. But let us not fool ourselves that that would be no loss whatsoever. The real question is life a journey like that of Abraham and Sarah to the promised land, a land to an open future which we make in covenant with God, or is it a journey like that of Oedipus to a noble but tragic fate already pronounced before he was born by the Delphic oracle, i.e. the inescapable iron hand of the past. I have argued that a synthesis that lasted 2,000 years between ancient Israel and Greece is breaking down. But we are left with the possibility that in Judaism is an actuality of seeing science and religion as two different things that don't necessarily need to coincide with one another. Science is what we need to understand objects. Religion is what we need to understand free subjects. Science takes things apart to see how they work. Religion puts things together to see what they mean. Science without religion is as short-sighted as religion without science. They go together like the twin hemispheres of the brain. We need them both. I believe not lightly that Judaism has been and is called on to continue to be the voice of hope in the conversation of humankind. And I believe the survival of Jews and Judaism throughout history, after all the exiles and expulsions and forced conversions and inquisitions and auto da fe and ghettos and pogroms, even after the Holocaust, the survival of Judaism, despite all of that, is testimony to the living power of that hope. Judaism is the West's voice, a faith in the future tense, the faith of Ehyeh Asher Ehyeh, of God and humanity, who will be what they choose to be and will honor one another. And therefore, however tense the future will be in the 21st century, the Jewish voice will remain a voice of inextinguishable and unconquerable hope. Thank you very much.
tonight in this room. The Chief Rabbi has kindly agreed to take a number of questions from the floor, and there are some mics being passed around. If you have a question, please raise your hand, and we can call on you, or someone can bring you a microphone. Yes, right here.
Rabbi, 6 years ago you wrote beautifully about the parsha that we're reading this week, and Jacob's fear and his distress over his about to reunite with his brother. And you spoke about, you used Rabin's words to talk about the Jewish sense of morality and conflict, and you idealized moral conflict when one has to be a soldier, and moral conflict when one has to do something that they know is absolutely right to do, but they know it causes harm and hurt to others. That was 6 years ago. I'm wondering if you have any reflection on that in light of recent events.
Can you repeat the question?
The question really is, can any Israeli, can any Jew feel anything other than a sense of tragedy in the light of events that have just taken place in Gaza? The truth is, you cannot be a Jew and not weep at such things. And at the end of the day, since I know these areas, Sderot, Ashkelon, Ashdod, let alone Tel Aviv, where I have two brothers working there and a niece living there, and I have, you know, four nephews in Sahal at the moment, and I can tell you they are pained by every moment of it. I want to say something here which I hope will not be misunderstood. We are coming up to Hanukkah. And if you have a look at Maimonides' Laws of Hanukkah, chapter 4, the last three halachot, the last three laws, he says something absolutely extraordinary. He says, Ne mitzvat Hanukkah chaviva imod, sorry, the command of lighting candles on Hanukkah is very precious. Of course, the Jewish victory over the Seleucid Greeks of Antiochus IV in the 2nd century BCE. And therefore, even if you only have something to eat, because through charity, you should beg or borrow or sell your possessions in order to buy oil to light for Hanukkah. In the last two paragraphs later on, in the last law, in the Laws of Hanukkah, he asks the following question. Now, this is a crazy question, but listen to it. Hanukkah lasts 8 days, so there's always a Shabbos in Hanukkah. So it comes Friday afternoon, and you only have one candle. What do you light it as, a Hanukkah candle or a Shabbos candle? You would have thought Hanukkah, because it only comes once a year, Shabbos comes everywhere. Besides which, Hanukkah commemorates a miracle and Shabbos doesn't. However, the law is, you light it as a Shabbos candle and listen to these words of Maimonides. Why do the lights of Shabbos take priority? Because the Shabbos lights represent peace in the home. And these are his words, greatest peace, for the Torah was only given to make peace in the world. Now, I want you to reflect on this. Hanukkah was the greatest military victory in ancient Jewish history. It was the defeat of the Syrian branch of the Alexandrian Empire, and it was the only historical event associated with any Jewish festival in ancient times that is recorded in non-Jewish literature. There's no record of the Exodus in all the records we have from ancient Egypt, and they have copious text written in hieroglyphics on temple walls. There is no reference to the events of the Book of Esther, even though it says in the Book of Esther, is this not all written in the Chronicles of the Medes and Persians? So far, reading the Chronicles of the Medes and Persians, we haven't found it yet. However, all the ancient historians told the story of Hanukkah because it was a world-changing event. It was the beginning of the end of Greece and the beginning of Rome. It changed history. And here comes a culture and says, faced with a choice like this, the smallest fragment of peace takes precedence over the greatest victory in war. And when a people believes that in its very bones, it only fights to defend its citizens, and every act of fighting it does with tears, either visible or inward. And therefore, let us all pray that sense will prevail in the Middle East, and finally, there will be peace for all the inhabitants of the land.
I'm wondering if you could speak to that phrase that you said, the meaning of the system is outside of the system, and its implications for Jewish law, halacha.
I don't think we can have legal positivism in Jewish law. That is to say, you know, there was, it's not my subject, forgive me, but there was a law professor at Harvard called Robert Cover, is that his name?
Yes.
Yes.
Yale.
At Yale. Shazi, some of my subject. I became a rabbi in order not to be a lawyer. You know, I do something, I'd be the only Jewish guy who's not a lawyer, you know, or a doctor. So I don't know, but he wrote, of course, a great essay on law and narrative. And one thing is absolutely clear, and this is basically the structure and principle of the Book of Numbers. Nobody can work out the structure and principle of Numbers. It looks like a great big jumble. But what you will see is blocks of narrative followed by blocks of law, followed by... In other words, in Judaism, law arises out of the concrete historical experiences of a people and of the ideals and aspirations that their supreme legislator, i.e. God himself, has for that people. God empowers his people not to legislate. And indeed, that is the uniqueness of a king in Israel, that the king had no legislative power. And when it came to interpreting the law, again, the king has no priority over anyone else. So God creates the law, but hands it to all of us to interpret and gives us the basis for that interpretation, both in terms of the ultimate values of the system, all of which are contained in strange ways in the early sections of the Book of Genesis. You know, it's like the last movement of Beethoven's... No, it's like the Grosse Fuge in Beethoven, if you know. But first, the themes are set out, and then come the variations. Are you with me? So the thematic... So, for instance, monogamy is there in Genesis 2. Therefore shall a man leave his parents and cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That's monogamy. Now, you know, monogamy didn't become law in Judaism until the 10th century and the institution of Rabbeinu Gershom, but it's already there at the beginning. As I've tried to imply, the freedom of the individual is already there as the guiding subject of the early narratives of Genesis, you know? They're all about evasions of responsibility. When Adam and Eve sin, Adam blames his wife, the wife blames the servant. Please, sir, it wasn't me. You know, the kind of stuff. Then Cain says, I. It's all variations on the theme of evasion. All of this, the principles set out at the beginning, and the narrative, the concrete historical narratives, which are interwoven with law, all tell us that law is not a mere fiat, God saying, thus shall be the law. Although there were some people who seemed to say this. When Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai says, I have issued a decree, I have made a ruling, you have no right to question my rulings. That's another subject for another day, okay? So in Judaism, the application and interpretation of the law must always be guided by the overall principles that lie beyond the legal structure and form the narrative structure of the Jewish experience as a whole and God's principles embedded in creation as a whole. Yeah? Now this is not necessarily the standard jurisprudential interpretation of halakha that you will get from some contemporary halachists. But to my mind, this view is absolutely, unarguably the truth. And halachic positivism, that's the law, accepted or not, does not fit with all the facts of either biblical or early rabbinic exegesis as we know it. Okay? Yeah.
So I'm wondering how we can transcend our ethnocentricity in order to create peace and bring about human progress and evolution, while at the same time maintaining our Jewish identity and practice.
Oh gosh, guys, the Vice Chancellor was kind enough to mention a little book of mine called The Dignity of Difference. That's my book-length answer to that question. Here it is in one sentence, by being what we uniquely are, we contribute to the common good what only we can give. That makes sense to you? That's how, by being true to our particular identity, we contribute to the universal good. Right.
In your vision tonight, you discussed scientific thought, which is past-oriented, and religion, which you view as future-oriented. And I want to ask about the omission, presumably intentional, of philosophy and philosophical thought. Do you view that as concomitant with scientific thought, or is there some special task that philosophical thought contributes?
Well, look, I was doing philosophy at a difficult time in Britain in the late 1960s, early 1970s, which was the great age in Oxford and Cambridge of what was known as linguistic philosophy, which I called, high-class lexicography. And I failed to see this grappling with the perennial issues of philosophy. And when I was studying with Bernard Williams, oddly enough, he was saying to me that he didn't know how to write moral philosophy. The year we parted, he actually published his first book on the subject, a little book called Morality, and thereafter became one of the greatest moral philosophers of our time. But I abandoned philosophy at that time because I thought it was arid, it was superficial. Worse than that, it was philistine. It had no sense of history, of the history of ideas. And it was almost accidentally, by reading a book, I'm sure you must be familiar with it, published in 1981 by Alastair MacIntyre, called After Virtue. And that book, I just read it, I was transfixed by it, and it brought me back to philosophy. It did for moral philosophy what Isaiah Berlin did for political philosophy. It gave back to philosophy its richness, its history, its engagement with the ultimate problems that people face, but face in particular times and situations. And since then, the work of people like political philosophers, Michael Walzer, Michael Sandel, beloved friend Charles Taylor at McGill, and so on. His wonderful book on sources of the self in a secular age. These, to me, have given back philosophy its drama, its richness, and there's some absolutely magnificent work being done in philosophy at the moment. So there was a time when I felt that philosophy was just losing the plot. And actually, I think in some ways, philosophy is more challenged. Nobody's, I know, has said this, were more challenged by the scientific atheists than religion is. because all sorts of things that used to be matters of philosophical speculation, especially in relation to the mind, for instance, which are now just being dealt with by neuroscience. And so philosophy has to, in the philosophy of mind, probably has to recover some thickness and depth there, because some of the best writing right now is being done by scientists like Steven Pinker and some very interesting work. So, but certainly in moral and political philosophy, it has roared back from what had become a very arid period, and now I read it with great interest. And whenever I have a spare moment, I try and teach a little bit of it as well. Yeah.
I'd like to get back to the title that was given for your address about the future of Judaism. It raised the question of what I'll call factionalism within Claudius Roel. And I think that the factionalism, in terms of the increased importance of denominationalism, Reformed, Conservative, Orthodox, Modern Orthodox, and their English counterparts, liberal, orthodox, whatever. And more broadly, in terms of Israeli society, where Dati, low Dati, and also Haredim. It seems to me that this is a problem that is likely to accelerate, rather than diminish. And what does this do, and what does this portend, if you will, for Jewish future?
Let me be very blunt with you here. Jews may be divided in their faith, but they are never divided in their fate. In their fate. And therefore I believe we are bound by a Brit Goral, a covenant of fate, which affects all Jews, whether they're halachically this, or orthodox that, or reformed that, or secular that. And therefore I believe that somehow or other we have to transcend our differences and be willing to do what Jews have traditionally done, which is argued together. I call this, I say, Judaism is a conversation scored for many voices. And every one of us, the atheist, the secularist, I have done many public dialogues with Jewish atheists, from Steven Pinker at Harvard to Howard Jacobson or Alain de Botton in London to Hamas Oz in Israel. I love these people, because I don't try and convert them, I try and listen to them. Because every one of them has something to say. Because Ben Zoma said, Ezehu chachama lo megmi kom adam. Because who is wise? Somebody who is willing to learn from everyone. And who is unwise? Somebody will only listen to people who agree with him. And therefore, I say to you, we have to transcend our differences. Otherwise, the result will be not hope, but tragedy. Let me be very blunt with you. We have been a people for 4,000 years. Three times our people went into exile. Once in the days of Joseph. A second time after the Babylonian conquest. A third time after the Roman conquest. And why? For the same reason, the inability of brothers and sisters to live together. Joseph's brothers planned to kill him and sold him as a slave. After a mere three monarchs, Saul, David, and Solomon, the kingdom split into two and became indefensible. And as for the Second Temple period, according to Josephus, there were so many factions that the Jews in Jerusalem were busier fighting one another than the Romans outside. Now, I want you to work this one out. Jews have been assaulted.
by almost every empire in the history of the world, by the Egyptians, the Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Greeks, the Romans, the Christian and Muslim empires of the Middle Ages, all the way through in the 20th century to the Third Reich and the Soviet Union. Every one of those empires that seemed invulnerable in its day, that bestrode the narrow world like a colossus, has been consigned to history, and Jews can still stand up and sing, "Am Yisrael Chai, the people Israel lives," from which I infer there is only one people that can endanger the future of the Jewish people, and that is the Jewish people. Friends, therefore, let us learn to live together because we have no alternative.
Rabbi's videos on his website, if you Google Chief Rabbi. To answer a number of questions, you can find his books at our local bookstore, Avi Komen, on Claremont. But mostly I want to say, on behalf of the University of California, the Berkeley Institute, the Robbins Collection, every person here, we owe you a debt of gratitude and are so appreciative.